Nursing students are leaving the clinical classroom earlier than expected. I'm Glowing Gray, and I'll have more coming up.
500 coats were distributed here at Long Branch Library in Montgomery County, and as you can see by the line, there is a huge need in this community. I'm Michael Hernandez, and I have a story coming up.
A big change for Maryland basketball this past weekend. I'm Julia Joseph, live at Xfinity. CNS TV starts now.
The Omicron variant is here. What's Montgomery County doing about it? I'm Stephen Mailing.
Two Baltimore area casinos get ready to kick off legal sports betting. Governor Hogan is hoping to cash out. I'm Michael Hernandez, and this is CNS TV.
But first, we are coming up on a serious shortage in this country, nurses. And if we don't act fast to train more nurses, that could leave healthcare in this country in critical condition, right in the middle of a pandemic. Glory Gway joins us in the studio with the details. Glory?
Here's how dire this is. The nursing workforce needs to grow by 220,000 in just 8 years. The pandemic has affected the jobs of many all over the country. We've seen those on the front lines suffer from burnout or exhaustion, causing many to quit.
Nursing school is hard.
And it just got harder. Several nursing programs are accelerating their curriculum so students can get out of classrooms and into hospitals sooner.
You know, they need more workers, they need more nurses. We then need to graduate more students.
Nancy Kambaja is a nursing student working at MedStar Washington Hospital Center.
It's hard mentally, physically, emotionally.
She worries the rush to train more nurses might be a problem, citing last year's lack of in-person classes and now accelerating nursing programs.
Safety is the first thing we have to think of, safety of our patients. So they had less time in school. What can we do for them to be more comfortable caring for patients?
The assistant dean for nursing at Anne Arundel Community College echoes these concerns. He says the acceleration route may be fine for four-year institutions, but will be difficult for his two-year one.
I don't feel comfortable doing any type of acceleration with the students that I have in my in the program that I lead, because I would bypass certain points of evaluation that I know is essential for them to be good practitioners.
But Elizabeth Apple says nursing programs are working together with hospitals to not only hire early, but to make sure that students do get that hands-on experience.
We don't want those quick fixes, just get people out early. No. We've got to do it right. And I think we will do it right.
Olden says a better solution might be for students to become a part of the institution earlier.
We are making sure that our nurses and our graduates and new nurses not only have the skill set and capacity, but that they can start on the ground running at a much quicker pace.
Despite his concerns, Olden says he is optimistic about getting nurses into hospitals faster.
The early exit is a response to Governor Larry Hogan's call for nursing schools to create pathways for students to complete their programs faster. They have to meet specific requirements to have that early exit option. When students exit, they are not yet certified. The certification comes only after the set graduation date. So some hospitals in the area are hiring students as student nurses while they wait to take their board exams. Michael?
Thank you, Glory. Will your kids continue wearing masks or not? The Maryland State Board of Education met this morning to propose new mask regulations in schools. The board is recommending lifting the mask mandate if 80% of the students and faculty are vaccinated or if 80% of the county is vaccinated. If neither of those conditions is met, the superintendent can lift the mandate if the county has maintained 14 consecutive days of low or moderate transmission. From here, the proposed regulation goes to the Administrative, Executive, and Legislative Review Committee and then for public comment.
Since Pfizer's pediatric vaccine was authorized last month, about 35% of children living in Montgomery County have received a shot. County officials are hoping to bump those numbers up with their latest shipment. Containing over 23,000 doses, this is their largest haul yet. With the arrival of the Omicron variant, Montgomery County isn't taking any chances.
is not a drawing of a blood splatter, a broken wing pterodactyl, or a salamander having seizures. It's a map of Maryland's congressional boundaries, and although the state's zigzagging districts have been likened to all those things, on Monday, Maryland lawmakers passed a new map which would make the state's only Republican district more competitive for Democrats. It moved to the House of Delegates today and would bring the first congressional district into Anne Arundel County. The special session is expected to wrap up by Friday.
Now, as we begin to wrap up the fall season, we know that means we have to start getting ready for snow. And as you do, officials want to make sure you are not overdoing it with the salt. It can hurt our water supply. How much salt do you use on your sidewalks? A 12-ounce cup will cover 10 sidewalk squares or a 20-foot driveway. That's all it takes. Using more doesn't really do much more except creating runoff that ends up in streams, causing serious environmental damage. There may be some flakes in our forecast, so I'll have more later on in the newscast with weather.
After years of waiting for legal sports betting, it seems Baltimore casinos will finally be ready to play ball. The Horseshoe Casino Baltimore and the Live Casino Hotel Maryland plan to launch their sports books at the end of the week, assuming they get approval from the state. Each casino will be holding its own ribbon-cutting ceremony on Friday with Governor Hogan on both guest lists.
Is it the end of the Mark Turgeon era for Maryland basketball? Well, what are the Terps really worrying about? CNS's Julia Joseph is live outside of the Xfinity Center to explain. Julia?
If you've been to a Maryland basketball game, you've seen them before. They describe themselves as a group of guys who love making a fool out of themselves and love watching a good Maryland basketball game. They are the Turgeonites.
He comes up and he shows me like the Twitter thing, like Coach Turgeon's like stepping down.
My phone starts blowing up. People text me, what's going to happen to the Turgeonites?
And I was like, they're definitely just messing with me right now.
Everybody's saying like prayers out for the Turgeonites, like what's happening to the Turgeonites? I hope they're okay. And we started to realize like we have a bigger stranglehold on the Xfinity Center than we thought.
After just five NCAA tournament appearances, a Big Ten championship, and in the midst of his 11th season as head coach, Mark Turgeon and Maryland basketball decided it's time to part ways in a mutual agreement on Friday. He may not have left the championship legacy Terps fans had hoped for, but one thing that did come from the Turgeon era, the Turgeonites.
It's weird to describe to somebody who's not here, like who we are, what we do.
Yeah, it may be a little weird, but the Turgeonites have become a Maryland basketball tradition. Each game, a group of students are found dancing behind Maryland's bench, wearing a suit with a gray spot of baby powder in their hair.
Coach Turgeon has a little salt and pepper, so you gotta make it authentic.
The group even has custom dance moves for different plays.
And then threes.
Draw it.
Believe it or not, Friday's news has a lot of Maryland's fan base wondering, what's going to happen to the Turgeonites? Well, Terps fans, they have a message for you.
We're not leaving.
We feel, at least for the time being, that the official new name of the Turgeonites will be the Manningites.
As for the look of the Manningites, the group says winter break is their time for rebranding. Conversations regarding a new outfit, new dance moves, and the possibility of wearing a ball cap will be held. I'm Julia Joseph, outside the Xfinity Center, sending it back to you guys.
Thank you, Julia. One Confederate statue in Virginia is transforming from a symbol of hate to a work of art that will reflect racial justice. We'll show you who and how coming up.
Plus, we'll show you how UMD Hillel is putting a new spin on combating Jewish hate, next on CNS TV.
If I could go back and change it all, I would. I think I'm gonna miss you the most. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. Or maybe it's just the little moments. If I could go back and change it all, I would. But I can't.
When I was in foster care, I never knew when I would have to move. So I always had my suitcase ready to go. Then one day, I was adopted. My new parents opened their hearts and home to me. My parents cook my favorite breakfast for me every morning. My parents take me on trips I never thought I would go on. They gave me a home and an even better reason to use that suitcase. My parents aren't perfect, but they're perfect for me.
Jordan knows he shouldn't eat this entire bowl of nachos, but tonight he's earned that right. Because a few hours ago, in the middle of happy hour, he recognized a sign. Not from the gods or a bolt of lightning, but from a double heart, a kissy face, and a fourth ha in ha ha ha. That's when Jordan knew he was buzzed. So when it was time to go, he got a ride home instead of driving. Be a legend like Jordan. Recognize your buzzed warning signs and get a ride home. Buzz driving is drunk driving. Jordan.
Welcome back to CNS TV. Prince George's County Police need your help tonight. They're searching for an 18-year-old suspect in the murder of a 19-year-old man. Luis Miguel Utura was found dead inside a crashed car in University Park last month. Now Andreas Aguilar faces charges of first and second degree murder. Police have a warrant and are searching for Aguilar, but so far no arrest has been made. Anyone with information is asked to contact Prince George's County detectives.
Charlottesville's Robert E. Lee statue will be melted down and turned into a piece of public art to reflect racial justice and inclusion. The City Council of Charlottesville voted on Tuesday to donate the statue to the Jefferson School African American Heritage Center, who haven't decided what the new artwork will look like. The statue was removed in July. And 4 years ago, a plan to remove the statue drew white nationalists to Charlottesville for a rally that led to violence, including the death of a counter-protester.
Montgomery County is paying homage to one of the most fearless women in our nation's history. It has been a little over 66 years since Rosa Parks refused to give up her bus seat to a white person. And now, Montgomery County's buses have signs commemorating her. The signs were created to celebrate equal rights and remind riders of Parks' legacy to end segregation.
And a recent event on campus is also working to end discrimination. Hanukkah brought them together for 8 nights, but they remain united against hate. Allison Goldblum is in the studio with more. Allison?
Thank you, Michael. Hanukkah is also known as the Festival of Lights. It's a time for Jewish people to gather and celebrate as a community. Hillel's Spin Love, Not Hate event served as a reminder that hate and bias have no place on this university's campus.
Together using a dreidel spin to show that unity around Hanukkah of a time to respect one another and care for one another is really what our hope is from this event.
The university's Hillel hosted Sunday night's Spin Love Not Hate event. It was a festival of joy where students could enjoy Hanukkah foods and spin a dreidel. But it was so much more than a gathering for celebration.
I am a mom. With a hope in my heart.
In 2017, Don Collins' son, Second Lieutenant Richard Collins III, was murdered on campus. The student who killed him identified with an alt-right white supremacist group.
Most of you are unlikely to have another period in your life to get to know people from many backgrounds outside your college campus. Participate in cross-cultural dialogue.
University President Dr. Daryl Pines showed his support for the Jewish community by lighting the menorah and spinning dreidels with students.
So for Jewish community to learn about other cultures as well as other communities to learn about Jewish culture, it is the university that does that. So this is indeed the place in which students can find their home, feel safe, learn about other groups, and make a difference in the world.
Jewish student Alexander Brian Taft agrees with President Pines and says he's still learning about all of the resources on campus to uplift his community.
I've generally felt safe here. I've been lucky enough that I haven't experienced any incidents of anti-Semitism, but definitely events like this help.
Hundreds of students of various religious and cultural groups participated in Spin Love, Not Hate. Hillel Assistant Director Dawn Savage says she hopes this event made students feel seen and heard.
We try to create a space where students feel like they can be a part of our community and be a part of the Jewish community proudly.
It was certainly special to see these different cultural groups come together to tackle hate. Again, Hanukkah may be past, but Hillel and its partners say they remained unified going forward. Back to you at the desk.
Thank you, Allison. Now, I hear one high-profile Maryland program made national news on Friday.
They did, but not for a reason anyone expected. Katie Moore is next to sports. What do you have for us, Katie?
Well, guys, it has been a shocking weekend in College Park, to say the least. I've got more on how Mark Turgeon's team is faring without him and a look into the diversity in Big Ten head coaching. Stay tuned.
Baby, you see, I cannot set you free.
That's why I'm never gonna let you go. Never gonna let you go. Babe, I'm never gonna let you go. No, no, never gonna let you go.
Here you go.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Never gonna let you go. Never gonna let you
go. Oh, sweetie. Okay, you know what? Let's take off his sweatshirt. Get rid of pictures of him. You don't have to look at him. Goodbye, Dave.
Mom, you don't understand. He's tagged in like 400 of my posts.
I can cut out tags.
No, that's not how it works.
What is a tag?
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. Thousands of teens in foster care would love to share their first with you.
Había un niño que era muy sensible a luces y sonidos. Construía escondites donde no podían entrar. No le gustaba mirar a la gente a los ojos. Lo hacía sentir incómodo. Un día se descubrió que tenía autismo. Con ayuda, poco a poco, aprendió a vivir mejor con ello.
Mientras más pronto se diagnostique, mejor. Conoce las señales en autismspeaks.org.
On Wednesday, he walked off the court to fire Turgeon chants, and on Friday, he left the program.
Katie Marr is here to give you the details in sports. Katie?
Yeah, guys, Mark Turgeon led Maryland men's basketball for 10 years, so the question everyone's asking right now is what made him leave? The speculation around Mark Turgeon's departure is all over the place, but what we're starting to grasp is that external factors really drove this decision. A lack of support from your fan base, pressure from boosters and alumni, social media accounts dedicated to getting you fired, a then 5-3 record from a team that was ranked 21st in the preseason AP poll, it all adds up. Even though Turgeon signed a 5-year, $5 million extension back in the spring, the writing was on the wall when he walked off the court Wednesday night against Virginia Tech to booze and fire Turgeon chants. If this team didn't make the NCAA tournament, which according to bracketology now, they're not going to, we likely would have seen him out at the end of the season. And don't forget, Maryland won a share of the Big Ten championship just a year and a half ago, so the timing of this has a lot of people shocked. And it left the team emotionally rocked. Assistant head coach Danny Manning, who was hired by Turgeon in the spring and is one of his close friends, has been named interim head coach in his absence. And he led the team in its Big Ten opener at Xfinity Center on Sunday against Northwestern. And to no surprise, the offensive struggles for the Terps persisted. Maryland shot only 29% from the field, a stat that proved lethal in the 67-61 loss. A majority of the game was close, but in the final few minutes, the Wildcats surged ahead. Hakeem Hart led the way in the absence of some much-needed points from Eric Ayala and Dante Scott, but his 18 points and 7 rebounds were not enough to pick up the slack. The three-point shooting saw a bit of an improvement, but it wasn't enough. Here's Coach Manning after his first game at the helm.
I came to Maryland because of him. I wanted to work alongside him and learn from him. Nobody wanted to win more than Turge. He won here at Maryland. He won in a tough conference, and he won a lot.
After the game, Northwestern head coach Chris Collins, who has coached against Mark Turgeon for years, said he hopes Turgeon is being celebrated here for his tenure at Maryland. Now, I know that was a lot of basketball talk, and it's still football season. And if you're a Washington football team fan, you've got a lot to be happy about right now. Common phrase you might hear this time of year is "No Win November," dedicated to teams who didn't win a single game in the month of November. But Washington simply could not relate. The football team won all four of its games this past month, and on Sunday it took down a Raiders team hot off a big win against the Cowboys on Thanksgiving. And the man of the hour, Taylor Heinicke. The guy threw 23 for 30, notching nearly 200 passing yards and 2 touchdowns. He is certainly proving why he belongs in the starting position and why Washington should want to keep him around for a while. Washington will host NFC East rival Dallas, who sits atop the division, at home on Sunday, looking for a statement win against the Cowboys' red-hot offense. Now, there's one issue at the forefront of a lot of people's minds these days: diversity in sports, especially in women's and black-dominated sports. As someone who covers athletics at a Big Ten school, I got to thinking, what does a diversity in head coaching positions look like in this conference? So I decided to find a few people to talk to that are pretty qualified to speak on the subject and find out just how far the Big Ten has come and how far it still has to go.
One hand, I feel honored that I get this opportunity to kind of step into a really coveted role. And on the other hand, it's disappointing that there aren't more women of color who have either gotten the opportunities or who are you know, in these roles for a long, sustained period of time.
In 2021, the Big Ten filled all three of its open head coaching positions in basketball with people of color. Wisconsin women's basketball head coach Marissa Mosley was one of those hires, and she recognizes the value of young female athletes having a Black female head coach to look up to.
You can't be what you can't access, right? And so even if you can see it, it's almost worse if you can see it, you can't access it. So I think for you know, young women of color to see me in this position, to not only know it's possible, but then I can also tell them how you can go about doing that.
Now, it's no secret basketball is a diverse sport at the playing level. Out of 28 head coaches in Big Ten basketball, 12 are women, two of whom are Black and four are Black men. In comparison to the other Power Five conferences, the ACC has the Big Ten beat with five Black male basketball coaches. And the Big Ten falls in third place with Black female head basketball coaches behind the SEC's five and the ACC's four. However, the Big Ten's 12 female head basketball coaches is the most in the Power Five. But basketball isn't the only Black-dominated sport with a disparity in its coaching numbers. The University of Maryland is home to Coach Mike Loxley, who is one of three Black head football coaches in the Big Ten.
I think what it means to me is that the Big Ten obviously is at the forefront, if not at least one of the conferences, that it's important to them to have diversity.
While Coach Loxley can't speak for his players, he knows he brings something different to the table when he's recruiting young Black men to join his program.
I do know when I sit on people's couch and some of the players with, as we found through the coalition that I started, you know, 65% of the football players at the FBS level are minority football players, and that the representation of coaches is only around 13%, that there is a unique perspective that I bring when I go into a home, because a lot of these homes are a lot like the home I grew up in.
When asked if he thinks the lack in diversity in head coaching plays a role in Black student-athletes choosing an HBCU over a Power Five school, Big Ten Commissioner Kevin Warren said he thinks the diversity is strong.
I think because the Big Ten, you know, is the Big Ten, and we do have, you know, strong diversity in our coaching ranks. I mean, we all can do better, and we're focused on doing better, which we will. I think at the end of the day, you know, our student athletes want to make sure that they play for coaches who can just help them to get better, you know, one, as a person first, and secondly, as a student athlete.
Often the lack in diversity at the head coaching level is simply due to the lack of turnover, which lagged prior to 2019. But one important question to ask, who is making these decisions, and is there diversity in those positions? The Big Ten has three Black and five female presidents and chancellors, and five Black athletic directors. That's the most of any Power Five conference. Though diversity is a journey where most in college athletics have not reached the destination, strides are being made. And coaches like Coach Mosley and Loxley want the kids looking up to them to know they have someone in their corner.
Just dream big, you know. On the day I got into coaching, I dreamed that I would one day lead Maryland. And it's never going to be easy, and that you just got to continue to dream big and work toward achieving those dreams. And when you do have a chance to reach them, pay it forward by reaching back and giving back.
You can truly be anything that you set your mind to. If you don't see it, then go and make yourself that first so that other young women can see that it's possible.
My thanks to Coach Mosley and Loxley for speaking to me about such a personal subject and for sharing some really great insight. Now, guys, that's probably my favorite story I've ever told, and I not only enjoyed getting to talk to Coach Mosley, Loxley, Commissioner Warren, but learning all those facts, I feel like a better reporter for knowing it.
And Katie, that was an amazing story, just shedding light on such an important issue.
Yeah, I agree with Michael. It really is an important issue, and it isn't brought up that much, but recently has gained some traction, so hopefully they'll make some much-needed progress on this topic.
Absolutely.
Now, I'm dreaming of a white Christmas, but will we get one this year?
And will you be making snow angels tomorrow morning in the DMV? Stephen will have a full weather report coming up next on CNS TV.
Hey, Dad. I need your help asking Jessica to prom.
Of course. Love is like the ocean. You have to tread the
waters. Oh, Dad, that's not the kind of help I needed. Hey, Jessica.
Jessica.
Will you go to prom with me?
Yes.
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent.
Thousands of teens in foster care can't wait to share their first with you.
The black truck? Hey, Christina from accounting.
Yeah, hi.
Hey, I used to date a girl named Christina.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and then she dumped me for my best friend. You want to see some photos of them that I took?
I don't.
I thought we talked about this, buddy.
Buzz and overshared again?
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm gonna call a car.
That's a smart idea.
So yeah, I know. That's why I did it.
Hey, you're gonna get back to the top of the mountain.
Does that mean I'm gonna get back with Christina?
No.
Oh.
No.
Freedom. It's at the core of who we are. The freedom to live without fear. To jog where we please. To wear a hoodie. The freedom to breathe. Before we celebrate the freedom most Americans have, we must fight for the freedom all Americans deserve. Because all lives can't matter until Black lives matter.
Now, it has definitely been chilly over the past couple of days, and although that signifies winter weather, it may not last through December.
What kind of implications are we looking at, Stephen?
Well, Michael, actually, some forecasts are saying that we might be ending up with some warmer weather in the middle of the month, but they're talking about possibly a big snowstorm towards the end of the month. But, you know, let's focus on the next week, and let's take a look outside of College Park earlier today. Now, outside of College Park, this is right outside by Knight Hall. It was looking rather sunny. It was pretty nice outside, but, again, it was windy. It was really, really chilly. And while we look into our current conditions outside, no surprise here, it's cold, folks. Now, we're talking about the high 30s, around 38 degrees. The wind chill is being felt. We're talking about 5 to 7 mile per hour winds. So last night, obviously, you saw a lot of wind take its way. I heard some people had some trees fall on their cars, even some trees got uprooted. So the wind was definitely a factor last night. Now, there were some rumors circling around about snow possibly happening tomorrow and a snow day happening. That's not going to happen, folks. And while the temperatures proved to be perfect for snow to fall in the DMV area, I wouldn't really get your hopes up for a snow day. Because tonight, we're going to be dropping down to the low 30s, around freezing. So, yes, it is perfect snowmaking temperature. Wind will hover between 5 and 10 miles per hour. But just outside D.C. and Northern Virginia, they'll see the higher end of that, around 10 miles per hour due to the Potomac. But nothing on the radar indicating precipitation in our area. And even if it is, it'll be a blip, merely below dusting levels. But speaking of the radar, let's actually have a look at what to expect. Now, as you can see here, you can see that precipitation pushing in, actually. But if you see, looking over here, the radar's actually going to stop right around-ish because it's right where 95 is happening. So don't expect anything crazy. It's going to be more than like 1 to 3 inches up in northern Maryland, most likely, but nothing around here in the DMV area towards DC. And even though it's cold right now, as DMV residents know all too well, it'll warm up again this weekend. We're talking nothing above the mid-40s this week up until Friday. Friday, we're going to see a high of 56, but the rain is coming in. So we are going to see rain on both Friday and Saturday. And it's leading us into Saturday. Look at that high. It's 72 degrees, and it's December 7th right now. So next week, we're looking at the low to mid-50s. So you don't have to be all bundled up when you're outside. But remember that the early mornings and the late evenings will still be dropping down into the lower 40s. So be prepared for that. Now, something I found really interesting, like I mentioned before, Michael, is the fact that forecasters are saying we might be dealing with a warm front that'll stay here until around December 20th. And, you know, it might actually be a green Christmas here in DMV, although I very much prefer a white Christmas. But, you know, they're talking about the fact that there's a drastic change warm weather-wise. There should be one cold weather-wise as well on the other side of the equation. So it could be a big snowstorm coming up after the holidays.
I'm just looking forward to finally be wearing my pea coat.
I understand that. I love my pea coat as well, Michael.
And next, a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity that's sure to keep your eye on the sky.
Plus, as Montgomery County gets into the holiday spirit, the Long Branch Library has found a way to warm more than just hearts. We'll show you how next. Stay with us.
Jordan knows he shouldn't eat this entire bowl of nachos, but tonight he's earned that right. Because a few hours ago, in the middle of happy hour, he recognized a sign. Not from the gods or a bolt of lightning, but from a double heart, a kissy face, and a fourth ha in ha ha ha. That's when Jordan knew he was buzzed. So when it was time to go, he got a ride home instead of driving. Be a legend like Jordan. Recognize your buzzed warning signs and get a ride home. Buzz driving is drunk driving.
When I was in foster care, I never knew when I would have to move. So I always had my suitcase ready to go. Then one day, I was adopted.
My new parents opened their hearts and home to me. My parents cook my favorite breakfast for me every morning. My parents take me on trips I never thought I would go on. They gave me a home and an even better reason to use that suitcase. My parents aren't perfect, but they're perfect for me.
Here you go.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Leonard's comet has been barreling through the galaxy towards the sun for about 35,000 years, and December is your only chance to see it before it disappears forever. It'll be closest to Earth and easiest to see December 12th, but you'll need binoculars to spot the comet, which will appear slow-moving due to its distance from Earth, but actually be blazing through the solar system at over 150,000 miles an hour. Now, hundreds of Coates people waited outside Long Branch Library for winter coats. The lines extended through the doors, and a total of 500 coats were distributed. Our CNS's Michael Hernandez joins us in studio with the details. Michael?
Today's drastic drop in temperatures reminds us that this is a time of the year we need to look out for our neighbors. That's why Montgomery County and a legal aid organization are partnering to distribute hundreds of coats. County residents say they are grateful, especially during the holidays.
Hundreds of people lined outside Long Branch Library waiting to receive a free winter coat. Things are very expensive, and sometimes we have three kids, and this will help us a lot. It's a big support. Montgomery County, in partnership with Maryland Legal Aid, distributed 500 coats to the Long Branch community.
It saves us a lot of money that we can use in like house furniture or like food and school supplies.
The coats distributed here today were provided by Macy's and Clothes for Souls. In over a period of 9 years, they've provided over 270,000 coats for low-income families.
The community here in Long Branch, and particularly the Latino community, have often felt overlooked. We are working really hard to make sure that they are healthy and safe and educated and vaccinated and have food on the table and a roof over their heads.
Casa Rubin, a foundation that provides a vaccination to underserved communities, was also there.
This is very unique because we are in the heart of the community. In our community, there are two major factors. One is our parents and the adults work 2 and 3 jobs. It's very hard to have access to vaccines with an appointment on days when you work.
Just to be able to provide that today is to lift that burden off someone else's shoulders, and it's the importance of the community coming together in really challenging times and prioritizing what's important.
It's coming back. Maryland Legal Aid will continue to organize coat drives throughout the winter. The next one is in Baltimore County tomorrow. If you want to find out others or more information on coats and clinic events, you can visit mdlab.org. And guys, what a great initiative, especially during the holidays.
Yeah, for sure. You know, we always talk about holiday giving. That's always in the news. And, you know, it's nice because, like I said before, the weather is going to get chillier, so it's going to be important for them to have those coats.
Yeah, I need a new coat. You guys are talking about pea coats. I love pea coats. I haven't had one in years. I was looking for one on Black Friday weekend, but I didn't find one I liked for a good price.
Katie, I may have some tips for you. We'll talk after the show.
I mean, that could be because of the material shortage, though.
Or because I'm a broke college student, but that too.
Fair enough. But make sure you check us out online at cnsmaryland.org and follow us on Twitter at CNSMD.
You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/MarylandCNS and on YouTube at CNS Maryland.
Thank you for joining us. Have a good evening.